Welcome to the synthesis of yoga, the book that changed my life. We are on the 36th episode. We have completed the introduction, which has five chapters. And then we have moved on to the first part, which is the yoga of divine works. And we are on the very first chapter, the four aids, and the 14th paragraph of this chapter. The link to this chapter is there in the description. And in the last episode, we have touched upon the effort part. Out of the four instruments, which are the knowledge, shastra, second one is the effort, abhyasa. We are on that second instrument, the effort that is required. And we know in integral yoga, the three stages, where first is the turning of the individual soul, turning towards the divine. And that intensity of the turn will define the rapidity with which you progress on the path. So first is that seeking to find, to come in touch with that divine reality. And second is reception of it. Third is a well-transformed instrument ready for the action in the world. So in which the effort part of the seeking and the turning, the intensity of turning, where the intensity of aspiration, the applied will, perseverance, all that would define the speed with which you would progress on the path. But at the same time, having once chosen by the divine consciousness, victory is assured no matter how long it takes. Now let's move on to this paragraph. Paragraph number 14. Always indeed, it is the higher power that acts. This is in the context of personal effort to contact the higher consciousness. And the larger picture is, it is always the higher power that acts, even when we experience it as our own individual seeking and effort. And this you will find consistently being stressed upon by Sri Aurobindo across this book. Always indeed, it is the higher power that acts. Our sense of personal effort and aspiration comes from the attempt of the egoistic mind to identify itself in a wrong and imperfect way with the workings of the divine force. So there is a divine force that is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent, always present, acting through all. But we are cut off from it. And there is an egoistic mind which has become self-aware and it is seeking. And it has a deep sense of separation. And from that poises the seeking happens. So our sense of personal effort and aspiration comes from the attempt of the egoistic mind. So that sense of effort comes from this sense of egoistic mind to identify itself in a wrong and imperfect way. Identify with what? With the workings of the divine force. There is a right identification and there is a wrong identification. The egoistic mind has a wrong identification in an imperfect way that gives the sense of personal effort and personal aspiration. In fact, even the aspiration is a universal movement operating through all. In us, it will become conscious. And because we are bound by the egoistic mind, we experience the whole thing as our personal effort. We are identified with a tiny little formation on the surface. Therefore, we experience this as our personal effort. So our sense of personal effort and aspiration comes from the attempt of the egoistic mind to identify itself in a wrong and imperfect way with the workings of the divine force. It persists in applying to experience on a supernormal plane the ordinary terms of mentality, which it applies to its normal experiences in the world. So this mind is constantly translating that which is supernormal, and experiences on a supernormal plane the ordinary terms of mentality. We have our ordinary terms of mentality. Reduction of everything into the framework of I, me, and myself. Whereas the larger wisdom and power is acting through all. So in our early stages of awakening, when the random events happen, things are coming to our life, we are shaken out of our comfort zone, we are waking up, and we experience it as it is happening to me. And I am looking for a book, I am looking for a teacher, I am looking for a right community. All that is experienced as my effort, and I am lost, I am searching. This is how we experience, whereas it is something that is operationalized by a larger wisdom that is super normal, beyond our comprehension. But there is a mistranslation, a limited, narrow understanding and a narrow perspective. Therefore, we experience. It persists in applying to experience on a supernormal plane the ordinary terms of mentality, which it applies to its normal experiences in the world. So there is a ordinary terms of mentality which we apply to our normal experiences of the world, in the world, and we use that frame of reference and translate and transcribe all the higher experiences, even when it is intervening into our daily life, shifting it, pushing it into a new possibility. Because we cannot see the omnipresent wisdom working through all. Therefore, this mistranslation into our ordinary human terms. In the world, we act with the sense of egoism. We claim the universal forces that work in us as our own. We claim as the effort of our personal will, wisdom, force, virtue, the selective, formative, progressive action of the transcendent in this frame of mind, life, and body. In the world, we act with the sense of egoism. Ego is what gives us this clear sense of I am separate from you. And it is a limitation of our psychological cognitive system. It limits. Our senses are separating us from the rest of the world. And it is through the senses we are reaching out. And we clearly experience ourselves to be a separate entity. And all our experiences are gathered around and created an identity. And that is the small surface ego personality. So we act with the sense of egoism, that is our natural state. That sense of separation, things are happening to me, or I am the one who is doing things, acting upon things that are around. I am responding to it. I am separate. And there is this egoism. And we claim the universal forces that work in us as our own. The universal forces are working through us. In physics, we know gravity, there is nothing personal about gravity. It is Earth's gravity. Every mass gets attracted. And there is a universal principle of gravitation. And there is a custom version of gravity of Earth, gravity of Moon, and its effect on our individual body. And we consider that my weight is my personal weight of the body. There is a customized experience of something that is larger, universal. Psychologically, in the same way, or before that, physiologically, our very material substance, material body, is constructed out of the material substance of Earth. Hydrogens and carbons and oxygens and all that constructs our body. Though our body belongs to the body of Earth, but we experience our body to be a separate body that is capable of automation, walking around, and independence, self-defense, everything. That happens at a physiological level. And now extend this into psychological domain. Our thoughts, we experience it as our personal thoughts. Our emotions, we experience it as our personal emotions. Our energy, we experience it as our personal energy. In fact, if we look at our breath, breath is experienced as personal. I am breathing, but it is this whole earth that is breathing. A common life energy animating all life on the planet. And this life breath is woven into not just humans, but it is woven into the entire ecosystem. It is breathing through that, and we experience it as my personal breath, my personal thought, my personal emotions, my personal sensations. This is where the tiny fragment ego experiencing itself as a little island, a separate thing, which claims the universal forces. So we claim the universal forces that work in us as our own. This is one of the first delusions in which we live. We claim as the effect of our personal will, wisdom, force, virtue, the selective, formative, progressive action of the transcendent in this frame of mind, life, and body. So there is this transcendent power that is making the selection, that is creating the formation, and it has its progressive action. And that transcendent wisdom, the universal wisdom that is operating through all, it is making the selection, it is creating the formation, whether it is individual life formations and its relationships, or a collective movement, a nation's development, a civilization's rise and fall, all that are moved by the transcendent or universal wisdom. And it selects, it forms, and there is a progressive action. It does that. But that gets translated through our mind, life, and body. It has to flow through our individual body. And therefore, we claim as the effect of our personal will, wisdom, force, virtue. When we are engaging with the collective social action and we experience it as, I have made an impact in the world through my action. I am the author of action. This is the illusion we live with. But it is the transcendent that acts through the universal and through the individual and shifting things and leading and directing everything. So let me read this line once again. In the world, we act with the sense of egoism. We claim the universal forces that work in us as our own. We claim as the effect of our personal will, wisdom, force, virtue, the selective, formative, progressive action of the transcendent in this frame of mind, life, and body. Enlightenment brings to us the knowledge that the ego is only an instrument. We begin to perceive and feel that these things are our own in the sense that they belong to our supreme integral self, one with the transcendent, not to the instrumental ego. enlightenment, the elimination of the higher consciousness into the lower. That brings the clarity. That reveals the true picture, that ego is only an instrument. We are experiencing it as our own action. In fact, our true self is that universal and transcendent nature. That's our true nature, true self. It is that which is acting, and that perception becomes increasingly clear. We begin to perceive and feel that these things are our own in the sense that they belong to our supreme and integral self. Supreme and integral self. We are living in the fragmented self, whereas our higher self is integral. It is one with the whole universe. It is undivided, even when it is acting through the individuals. And we tied with the tiny little individual mold from where we are looking at, we experience it as our own. And this is only an instrument of that transcendent universal power, which is we are one with the transcendent, not to the instrumental ego. So we can shift the identification from the ego, small self, into the larger universal self and eventually the transcendent self. That's when we truly begin to perceive the world and its action from the right vantage point. Till that time, we are seeing it from the perspective of the tiny window of the ego and the instrumentality of the ego. And enlightenment brings this luminous perspective of an integral vision, an integral experience. With it, an integral knowledge, an integral power. So enlightenment brings to us the knowledge that the ego is only an instrument. We begin to perceive that, we begin to perceive and feel that these things are our own in the sense that they belong to our supreme and integral self, one with the transcendent, not to the instrumental ego. Our limitations and distortions are our contribution to the workings. The true power in it is the divine's. What we contribute is the limitation, obscurity, and distortion. Because our instrumental nature is narrow, therefore it distorts. And only a limited expression of the greater divine wisdom finds its way through the limiting mold of our individual ego-bound superficial surface personality. So our limitations and distortions are our contribution to the working. Often we think it is the divine wisdom. Why the divine wisdom is working in such an obscure way, creating so much violence, destruction, pain, and suffering in the world? We blame it on the divine wisdom. But reality is, it is the narrowness and distortions of our instrumental nature that causes suffering, causes pain, causes all kinds of destruction and violence. It is not the limitation of the divine wisdom. It is the limitation of our cognitive and affective faculties. When the human ego realizes that its will is a tool, its wisdom, ignorance, and childishness, its power, an infant's groping, its virtue, a pretentious impurity, and learns to trust itself to that which transcends it, that is its salvation. Here is a very interesting set of lines. When human ego realizes that its will is a tool, there is clearly an individual will, us. Nature has developed us into individuals and even shaped the ego. Remember, in the introduction part where Sri Aurobindo was referring to the integral movements of nature, the lower nature and higher nature, both are integral. And there is lower nature shaping the individual and particularly building up the ego so that we are experiencing ourselves as a separate conscious entity. And it has a will. And that will is only a tool. And it's wisdom, ignorance, and childishness. What we consider as our huge body of knowledge, which at its best we may call ourselves to be wise, and it's wisdom, the wisdom of the ego, is actually ignorance and childishness compared to the universal and transcendent wisdom. It's power and infant's groping. The power of this limited ego personality is like an infant's groping. It's very narrow, very limited, superficial, tiny, little capacity. Its virtue, a pretentious impurity. We take pride in our virtues. I am so virtuous, very kind and compassionate. I love everyone. I am so truthful. Which is behind it, since it is a perception born out of a tiny little narrow ego personality, we are not even capable of perceiving the underlying pretensions and impurities. So it's virtue, a pretentious impurity. Impurity. And learns to trust itself to that which transcends it. So once we recognize that our virtue is a pretentious impurity, our power is an infant's groping, our wisdom is ignorance and childishness, and will is a tool. Once we recognize it and learns to trust itself to that which transcends it. So we need to learn to trust that which is transcending us, our limited personality, trusting that great wisdom. And that is its salvation. The true freedom comes from learning to recognize and trust that greater will, wisdom, power, all that will bring us the true salvation. The apparent freedom and self-assertion of our personal being, to which we are so profoundly attached, conceals a most pitiable subjection to a thousand suggestions, impulsions, forces which we have made extraneous to our little person. We do experience ourselves to be independent and free, and we can assert ourselves, and we have our personal being, and to which we are deeply attached, to our personality, my identity, my worldview, my knowledge, my skill set, my little personality to which we are identified, my little talents to which we are identified, my little will to which I am identified. So, and it gives a sense of apparent freedom. I have certain freedom to do whatever I want. What we don't sufficiently recognize is that behind that apparent freedom is the most pitiable subjection to a thousand suggestions, impulsions, forces, suggestions. Our mind is constantly receiving thought suggestions, and we are not even aware of this reception. Mind is really like an antenna. It is receiving thought streams that enter as a thought suggestion, and we believe it is our own. And impulsions, the impulse to act. Many people say, I want to live in the present moment in a spontaneous way. I am going with the flow. Reality is a very pitiable slavery to impulses, inability to master it. And we build a philosophy of living in the present, going with the flow. I am free to do whatever I want. So suggestions, impulsions, forces. And there are all types of forces of nature working through us. And we believe it is our personal little force. And we think all these are external to us. We are separate, independent. It is extraneous to us. All the suggestions, impulsions, forces, these are all extraneous. I am independent. This is the illusion. So the apparent freedom and self-assertion of our personal being, to which we are so profoundly attached, conceals a most pitiable subjection to 1,000 suggestions, impulsions, forces, which we have made extraneous to our little person. Our ego, boasting of freedom, is at every moment the slave, toy, and puppet of countless beings, powers, forces, influences in universal nature. We have our ego that has emerged in nature. Nature shaped it. But once the ego wakes up, ego makes the claim of its independence, declaration of independence. And it forgets that it is part of the universal nature, not just material nature, but our psychological nature, subjective nature itself is universal. Because our thoughts, our emotions happens in our subjective space, and we are not able to perceive someone else's thought, someone else's emotions, except in terms of outer gestures and facial expressions, we believe that ours is a very personal, private, internal experience. This is a delusion. Nature is universal, not just material nature, psychological, subjective nature is universal. Thoughts are universal, there is a universal mind. Life energy is universal, there is a universal life, universal matter. So our ego boasting of freedom is at every moment the slave, toy, and puppet. It's a slave of universal forces. It's a toy being played around by the forces of nature. And a puppet. It's a toy, a puppet. Strings are pulled by nature. We can see it in animal world. They respond according to seasons and according to their impulses. It's very, very evident. When it is mating season, animals are in heat and they cannot control. It is nature's working, biological forces working through them. And we carry an illusion that we are independent, we can master these things. But we are pretty much slaves of the forces of nature, whether it is hunger, desire, ambitions, cravings, all that are driving through us. Even what appears as our independent thoughts, thought formations, and impulse to act, do this or that project in the world, these are all part of larger universal nature's working. We are the instruments of nature. And we forget that very conveniently because we are unable to perceive. And we are not able to perceive because our current worldview and education is training us to believe ourselves to be independent, a tiny little ego personality striving and struggling in the world and suffering in the world. It is a prison of the ego. Our ego, boasting of freedom, is at every moment the slave, toy, and puppet of countless beings, powers, forces, influences in universal nature. When we hear the word beings, powers, we have an anthropocentric perspective. We are human beings. Then there are other animals, which are also living beings, Up to tree, we allow there is a being, living tree. But beyond that, our sense of being is ending. The stone, the physical being, it's dead. There is no life in it. Beyond that, the forces of nature that is working through, we cannot perceive. For example, the wind that is blowing through, the life current that is flowing through, for us, it is just a mechanical force of nature, moved by the difference in temperature on the surface of Earth. So Earth, air currents are moving from here to there. We have a very good material scientific explanation of the process of wind. Or the fire, we can explain in terms of physics, the plasma of the flame, or the gas formations when it is burning, the oxidation, the entire chemistry, physics, we can explain. And we believe we understood by explaining. The being behind the fire, the being behind the wind, these are alien concepts to our modern civilization. But when we look at the Vedic rishis, they saw the living powers behind what appears to be the flame, Agni, what appears to be the wind, what appears to be the sun, what appears to be the lightning, what appears to be the water. But we explain water in terms of hydrogen and oxygen, and we believe we know. We understood. We know nothing. The being behind water, the being behind earth, the being behind air, being behind the fire. That perception we don't have. The universal forces that are working through, the conscious beings, powers that are working through nature, we are clueless. And yet we do have the illusion and arrogance of knowledge. Accumulated knowledge, we can explain the whole workings of an atom, of a molecule, whole chemistry, whole physics. Therefore, we know. And that knowledge itself becomes a prison of our ignorance. We don't conceive the levels of being that is beyond this tiny little individual human being, or animals, or birds. We cannot see the larger universal beings and their powers. So here Sri Aurobindo is talking about of countless beings, powers, forces, influences in universal nature. There's a whole range of mental beings, the vital beings, the physical beings, and the corresponding worlds to which we have very little knowledge. But the ancient body of yogic knowledge had that knowledge. And that's where the whole science of occultism come into the picture, by playing with the forces of nature that are beyond the physical dimension. That's where Tantra and its tantric knowledge of the world and powers and beings, which gets translated into psychological terms or story forms in the name of gods and devas, asuras, all types of beings out there. So that's a whole vast body of knowledge which our modern man has largely lost, because we are materialistic in our perception. And our cognitive window is limited to the tiny little ego, and the individuality of our personality creates the whole illusion and incapacity of perception. So our ego, boasting of freedom, is at every moment the slave, toy, and puppet of countless beings, powers, forces, influences in universal nature. The self-abnegation of the ego in the divine is its self-fulfillment. Its surrender to that which transcends it is its liberation from bonds and limits, and its perfect freedom. So one way out for this ego is self-abnegation. So we give ourselves, forget about ourselves, dissolve ourselves in that vaster existence. Self-abnegation, melting into it, merging into it, negating it, negating this tiny little island personality. It is from that experience, this many philosophies rose, which says no self. In that sense, this tiny little ego self is unreal. There is a larger true self that is beyond this ego self. So self-abnegation of the ego in the divine is its self-fulfillment. So self-fulfillment comes by that dissolution in the divine. It's surrender to that which transcends. It's a liberation. So that freedom, liberation comes from surrendering to that greater wisdom, from bonds and limits. So this is what will unpack our limitations, our bondages, and we experience perfect freedom. And this freedom is the freedom of the infinite, the transcendent universal wisdom that is working through all. The more we are able to open to it, surrender to it, and as it operates and flows through us, we experience the levels of freedom and ananda of being, transcending the limits of the mold of ego. And with that comes tremendous freedom. That's the true liberation. So the self-abnegation of the ego in the divine is its self-fulfillment. Its surrender to that which transcends it is its liberation from bonds and limits, and its perfect freedom. But still, in the practical development, each of the three stages has its necessity and utility, and must be given its time or its place. So on one hand, there is this perception, this understanding, which is at a universal and transcendent level, to see that divine wisdom that is operating through everyone. But on the other hand, we have the practical necessity, a practical development of our individual yoga, our individual journey. There we need to recognize the three steps of the yoga. First step is the attempt of the individual to contact the universal and transcendent. Second step is the reception and transformation. Third is the action of the perfected center. In these three stages, there is a practical necessity and a practical development. We need to consider them as three major steps on the way. In the practical development, each of the three stages has its necessity and utility. So there is a necessity of the individual who has the sense of effort and struggle seeking. There is a necessity for it. And then there is a second stage where there is a necessity of the purification and liberation, elimination of the instrument, preparing it. Then the third stage of the perfected instrument acting as a center in the world. And there is a clear necessity for these three stages and must be given its time or its place. And each stage has its time. There is a certain period of proper development for each stage. So there is a time for it and a right place in the scheme of things. It will not do, it cannot be safe or effective to begin with the last and highest alone. This is where the premature rushing into the last stage, the illusion that I am already the divine center in the world and I am already free, all the impulses are nothing but that divine wisdom acting through me. And this is the major delusion in which one can fall into. We cannot start with the third stage. Yes, in theory, it is true. Everything is nothing but the divine in its disguise, operating through everyone, everything, every second. While that being the case, there is a reality of the individual instrument at its readiness and its understanding and comprehension and possibilities. Therefore, one cannot start with the third stage. Even at an absolute level, that is truth. We are in the relative context of our individual development. So it will not do. It cannot be safe or effective, because it can be very dangerous, and we see it happening to people. Premature conclusions, misconceptions, misunderstanding, and it can be disastrous to yoga. So it cannot be safe or effective to begin with the last and highest alone. It would not be the right course either to leap prematurely from one to another. You cannot also leap prematurely. There is certain ripening required at every stage. Then only you can safely move on to the next stage. You cannot just leap prematurely. So it would not be right course either to leap prematurely from one to another. For even if from the beginning we recognize in mind and heart the Supreme, there are elements in the nature which long prevent the recognition from becoming realization. There is recognition and realization. These are two different things. From the very beginning, we can understand conceptually, theoretically, yes, everything is nothing but the divine, the supreme consciousness. One existence. Wonderful. But that's only a cognitive reality. We recognize that as a knowledge. But it is not a realized fact in our daily life, encounter with the rest of the life. And there are elements of the nature which long prevent the recognition from becoming realization. There is a recognition of the universal self. It's a cognitive process. But there are elements that prevents it from a realization. In us, in our individual and collective being, there are elements that are pretty much obscure and opposed and limited and unwilling to arrive at that experience of oneness at a physical, vital, and mental level. Mind can conceptually grasp the idea wonderfully. And that itself often is so joyful to realize conceptual clarity that brings such joy. Often we confuse that for I have now realized. The realization is only a mental cognitive level, not a realization at all the levels of your being, and that too a conceptual understanding. For even if from the beginning we recognize in mind and heart, in mind and heart, even if your heart is recognizing the presence, it is insufficient. In mind and heart, the Supreme, there are elements of the nature which long prevent. It will prevent not just for a short period, but for a very, very long time. So long prevent the recognition from becoming realization. But without realization, our mental belief cannot become a dynamic reality. It is still only a figure of knowledge, not a living truth, an idea, not yet a power. There is a dynamic power of the divine consciousness. Even when our mind is able to recognize at a cognitive level the divine wisdom, all-pervading divine wisdom and presence, that doesn't become a dynamic, effective power in action. That's why we remain pretty much like a limited, narrow human instrument, in spite of having higher levels of cognitive capacities. Our doing capacity, our dynamic will and power is very, very limited. In fact, to such an extent, we know that certain habits are to be dropped. I do not want to be angry. You agree, you understand, theory is very clear. But in spite of that, nature goes on working repeatedly again and again, bursting out. So all kinds of impulses, whether it is sexual impulse or emotional habits or even mental habits, all that you want to change, yet you can't change because you don't yet have the power. You have the knowledge, but not the effective dynamic power for transformation. And our individual ego, mental mold and its will is tiny. It's incapable fundamentally to make a fundamental shift in our nature. So, without realization, our mental belief cannot become a dynamic reality. It is still only a figure of knowledge, not a living truth, an idea, not yet a power. Only when we have the power, living truth, dynamic power, dynamic reality, then knowing and doing goes together. What you know, you can do, you can become. But that's the journey to be made. And even if realization has begun, it may be dangerous to imagine or to assume too soon that we are all together in the hands of the Supreme, or are acting as His instrument. And we see it happening everywhere in the world, particularly with the narrow sectarian religious molds. We see people fighting because God has told me to fight for this or that. Intolerance and enormous violence done in the name of God. It is so common. Our tiny little island ego believes that I am the instrument of God and I am fighting for God. And that's the most dangerous thing that can happen to you. And we see it violently and at large scale happening to people, especially within the religious movements. Even in spiritual movements, people get into the illusion of now I am the instrument of the divine. And the related declaration, even going beyond the notion that I am the instrument of the divine, people begin to declare themselves to be the divine. I am the divine. I am God. I am the avatar. I am the Kalki avatar of the new era who has come to save the world. And these are the kind of delusions into which people fall into. Because when the ego mold is dissolved, you're opening to larger universal powers. And they would love to enter into you and give you the illusion and narrative that you are now the divine, identified with the divine. And on the top of it, it gets even more dangerous when you have some siddhis by which you can manipulate the masses, do some drama, whether it is materializing this or that, so that the vulgar mind of the masses get impressed and you play the role of a big guru. And these are the dangers on the path to be aware of. So, even if realization has begun, it may be dangerous to imagine or to assume too soon that we are altogether in the hands of the Supreme, the highest divine consciousness, or are acting as His instrument. Very big warning to be kept in mind, because often we enter into the path of yoga with this fantasy of becoming a great yogi and acquiring yogic powers and siddhis. Recipe for disaster, especially when the occult powers are beginning to manifest. Many of the realizations are beginning to happen. That's the most dangerous period to be on guard against this disaster. So even if realization has begun, it may be dangerous to imagine or to assume too soon that we are all together in the hands of the Supreme or are acting as His instrument. That assumption may introduce a calamitous falsity. It may produce a helpless inertia or magnifying the movements of the ego with the divine name. It may disastrously distort and ruin the whole course of the yoga. Your entire yogic development can get derailed when you get into this kind of delusions, especially when the siddhis and experiences begin to come. You have to be very, very careful and clear about it, because there are forces of nature that enter, and lights, visions, dreams, all that begin to communicate, the beings of the world. There are subtler worlds beyond the physical dimension, and there are beings, and they can manifest in this or that form, because the subtler worlds are not as rigid and fixed as our outer material physical world. So the subtle beings can shape themselves into any fanciful forms that we would recognize as the divine and come and say, I am merging with you now, you and me are one, and you are now the divine. We act in the world. I soham, you am I. And these kind of illusions can easily happen, and that can be disastrous to the sadhak. That assumption may introduce a calamitous falsity. It can be a calamity, a deep falsehood. It may produce a helpless inertia, because you may become a slave of a massive force that is working, and that uses you as a puppet in the world stage. That's where you become part of that, as a helpless inertia will drive you around. Magnifying the movements of the ego with the divine name. It is ego proclaiming itself to be the Bhagavan, the divine. I am the God. That declaration is typical of the ego amplifying itself, becoming huge and claiming itself to be the divine, claiming itself to be the God. It may disastrously distort and ruin the whole course of yoga. The entire development, you can get ruined. There's a period, more or less prolonged, of internal effort and struggle in which the individual will has to reject the darkness and distortions of the lower nature and to put itself resolutely or vehemently on the side of the divine light. So there is a period, more or less prolonged, of internal effort and struggle. Initially, we cannot even discern between what is the divine guidance and what is the lower nature's impulses. There is the movement of our already established evolutionary past of the lower nature, and there is the evolutionary future of the divine nature that is trying to enter and reshape. And we cannot distinguish between the two. What is the divine will? What is the divine inspiration? What is the right knowledge? What is the right discernment? This takes a long journey of purification to understand correctly. Therefore, during this period, there is a struggle because we are stumbling our way through. What we often consider to be the divine impulsion soon reveal itself to be a trap of the lower nature. Or what starts off as a clear, luminous inspiration coming from a higher source soon get absorbed and mixed up with the lower nature's ambitions, desires, impulsions. So there is a period more or less prolonged of internal effort and struggle. There's an internal effort. It is a psycho-spiritual transformation we are talking about. It's an internal effort that is required in purifying. Effort and struggle in which the individual will has to reject the darkness and distortions of the lower nature. There is quite some obscure forces within us. So the darkness and distortions of the lower nature, and to put itself resolutely and vehemently on the side of the divine light. So consistently, persistently, vehemently, resolutely putting ourselves on the side of light. That's a learning. And it takes time. It takes time to find our way, to learn to discern more and more precisely and clearly, and to get the signals right. That's a whole yogic training of purification of the instrumentation so that it can receive with clarity and precision without distortion. And it requires time, and you need patience to prepare the instrumental nature. The mental energies, the heart's emotions, the vital desires, the very physical being have to be compelled into the right attitude or trained to admit and answer to the right influences. So that's a training. There is mental energies. There are all kinds of mental energies. And there is heart's emotions, whole spectrum of heart's emotions, and vital desires. We are creatures of desires, ambitions, compulsions, and the very physical being, our material being, very physical being itself. They must be compelled into the right attitude. Mind has to develop the right attitude. The heart has to develop the right attitude. The vital has to develop the right attitude. Even the physical being has to develop the right attitude. Or train to admit and answer only to the right influences. The whole training so that our instrumental layers will not respond to anything lower, but only to the higher nature, to the divine influence, the fidelity to a higher truth, and to be sincere in that. Sincerity comes there, in that clear choice of higher nature's workings and surrendering only to that and nothing else. When we surrender to our laziness, when we surrender to our fear, when we surrender to our anger, when we surrender to our doubt, we are falling into the grip of the lower nature and its obscurities. Instead, we need to open ourselves to the light, beauty, and joy of the higher nature. It is only then, only when this has been truly done, that the surrender of the lower to the higher can be effected, because the sacrifice has become acceptable. Here, Sri Aurobindo is bringing in a very profound center conception of the yoga of divine works, the sacrifice. What we give to the divine. Yes, in the initial stages, everything is to be offered, but divine takes all that, purifies everything. And only when a purified, liberated offering, that becomes acceptable to the higher workings for the world action in the world. Till then, it is preparation. So the sacrifice will become acceptable. Your self-giving become acceptable when there is sufficient purification and transformation done. And then only you as an instrument become an acceptable instrument for the world action. Till then, it is the stage 1 and 2, the purification and preparation. So it is only then, only when this has been truly done, that is, instrument is responding only to the divine influence and nothing else, that the surrender of the lower to the higher can be effected. Surrendering to the higher can be effective successfully without any distortions, only when there is sufficient purity. Otherwise, you surrender, and what gets amplified is obscurity. So it is only then, only when this has been truly done, that the surrender of the lower to the higher can be effected, because the sacrifice has become acceptable. The personal will of the sadhaka has first to seize on the egoistic energies and turn them towards the light and the right. Once turned, he has still to train them to recognize that always, always to accept, always to follow that. So there is a personal will that is available to us as our tiny surface ego personality. There is a personal will. And the task of this personal will is to seize upon all the egoistic energies, whether it is mental energies, emotions of the heart, the vital impulsion, desires, cravings, or even the physical habits. Everything has to be seized by this individual will. And why are we seizing this? Why are we mastering them, controlling them? It is to turn them towards the light and the right. So we need to, this outgoing energies, driven by the senses, driven by the world, driven by the habits, habitually, unconsciously, dispersing into the world, we have to seize them. Then we have to turn them around towards the light, the right, the higher nature, the impulsions of truth and light, the right rhythm of movement of higher consciousness. So we have to, the job of the individual will is to seize upon all the energies from their outgoing movement and turn them inward and turn them around to recognize only the light and the right. And once turned, he has still to train them to recognize that always. Because habitually, our energies, our instruments, recognize the lower nature. It is still not used to recognizing the higher nature. So it has to be trained to recognize the higher nature, not just the higher nature, only the higher nature, more and more completely, with wholesome intensity of your being. The more you recognize the higher nature and its workings, always, that is a training required. He has still to train them to recognize that always, always to accept, always to follow that. So accept only that higher guidance and follow only that. The personal will of the sadhaka has first to seize on the egoistic energies and turn them towards the light and the right. Once turned, he has still to train them to recognize that always, always to accept, always to follow that. Progressing, he learns, still using the personal will, personal effort, personal energies, to employ them as representatives of the higher power and in conscious obedience to the higher influence. So as you begin to seize, turn them around and make them recognize the higher nature, higher divine workings, then we have to still use our personal will, personal effort and personal energies and employ them as representatives of higher power and in conscious obedience to the higher influence. With a conscious obedience to the higher influence, we put forward our personal will, personal effort, personal energies, everything as an obedient instrument of the higher divine will. Progressing yet further, his will, effort, energy become no longer personal and separate, but activities of that higher power and influence at work in the individual. So as you progress more and more, you would increasingly identify with the greater divine will, and you would experience it is really not my workings. It's a greater wisdom that is working. And that recognition becomes very, very clear, because things begin to happen in your life in a miraculous way, and you know that you have not done anything. It is a greater wisdom that is organizing and shaping things. And it is not your individual will. And that perception becomes increasingly clear as you progress on the path. So that's the third stage, where that personal effort becomes less and less. There is an increasing perception that it is that which is doing everything. So progressing further, his will, effort, energy become no longer personal and separate. There is still an effort, but you know that it is no longer personal. It is something else, and it is also not separate, but activities of that higher power and influence at work in the individual. It is that which is working through the individual and shaping things. You are only an instrumental condition. It is that which is working. And this is where you develop increasing humility, because you increasingly turn towards that will more and more and say, what is thy will, not my will? So that is where the growth takes you. But there is still a sort of gulf or distance which necessitates an obscure process of transit, not always accurate, sometimes even very distorting, between the divine origin and the emerging human current. Emerging human current. Human being is looked upon as a current. Human, you are a stream of consciousness that flowing in the world. Divine is streaming through you, this human instrumentation. A transmission happens, and there is a journey towards that. So there is still a sort of gulf or distance between the original source and the human current down here. The gap between the two is still to be bridged. So there is still a sort of gulf or distance which necessitates an obscure process of transit. An obscure process of transit. Not always accurate, sometimes even distorting, between the divine origin and the emerging human current. So from the divine origin, there is a transmission into the lower nature, into the human instrumentation. And in that process, there is a transmission loss, a distortion that takes place. And removing that distortion is the whole transformational work. So that instrument is increasingly capable of transmitting the original source, light and force, with the least distortion. And there is a work involved in it, where you are progressively identifying with the will of the divine, and you know that it is the greater will that is working, and you're surrendering to the right light and right force. At the end of the process, with the progressive disappearance of egoism and impurity and ignorance, this last separation is removed. All in the individual becomes the divine working. So as the ego gets thinner, and as it dissolves, increasingly this whole sense of separation also dissolves. And purified instrument is able to transmit without distortion, or with minimum distortion. the divine light and force and its impulsions in the world as the living center of its action. And you are no more experiencing yourself as anything separate. You don't have a separate existence. Only that exists. That works through the instrumentation. And you see only that around you in the world as that. Isha vasyam idam sarvam. And that's when that surrender becomes increasingly complete. At the end of the process, with the progressive disappearance of egoism and impurity and ignorance. Disappearance of egoism, impurity, and ignorance. This last separation is removed. All in the individual becomes the divine working. All in the individual. The mind gets divinized. The vital gets divinized. Eventually, ultimately, even the body gets divinized. And that's a promise of integral yoga. Divinization of all this. So that there is no separation. The divine consciousness is able to directly work through the instrumentation that is purified, illumined, liberated, and made plastic and expressive of the divine truth, divine rhythm, divine force, divine ananda, divine becoming in the world. So that's where the effort part takes you to. The profound identification. But there is a long journey to be made. A premature claiming that I am the instrument of the divine, it can be disastrous to the journey. There is a period of personal effort where the individual will seizes upon all the energies that are outgoing and scattered and turn them inward, make them recognize only the divine light and force, and train them to surrender to it and undergo transformation, purification, all that, and gradually merge and dissolve the ego and surrender to the divine will. And there is a journey to be made, and one must be prepared to make that journey and never to make a premature claim and hallucination that I am the divine instrument or I am the divine. So make sure such hallucinations, delusions doesn't grip, especially when the siddhis begins to show up. Realization begins to show up, especially when the mold of the ego is beginning to open up. We enter into the transpersonal spaces, which is opening to the universal and all kinds of forces and beings enter, claiming to be the divine. That's the intermediate zone that one has to be aware of. So with that, we are coming to the end of the episode number 36. Thank you for being with me in this journey. Share your views, your perceptions, ideas, suggestions for improvement. See you next week.